We'll get started. Welcome, everybody. Everybody hear me in the back? Yes? Okay, thanks. So before I have the pleasure of introducing today's speaker, I want to introduce the program and say a little bit about upcoming events. So first of all, I think most the people here know this is the Eric Schulman Distinguished Public Lecture Series, named in honor of Mr. Eric Schulman, who has been a great supporter of this series over the years and who unfortunately passed away this last year. And he and his wife Susie represent the kind of quintessential citizen interested in science and medicine in the community that we really wanted to target this program to when we started about 5 years ago. So we're very grateful for having this program named in Eric's honor. Secondly, I did want to mention some of the upcoming talks. Next week, as many of you know, is Brain Awareness Week, sponsored by the Dana Foundation and the Society for Neuroscience. It's a worldwide event. And as part of that event that we're celebrating here in Southwest Virginia, we're running something called Brain School, which we've done for, I guess this will be the fifth year we're doing that. And so next week, the lecture in this series on Thursday evening as part of Brain School will be given by Dr. Greg Duncan. And Dr. Duncan is from the University of California, Irvine. And he will be speaking about early childhood education, what works and what doesn't. And that's part of the whole week Brain School series. It starts off on Monday with a guy named Mike Friedlander. On Tuesday has Stephen LeConte, and on Wednesday, Sharon Ramey, followed by the keynote, which is the Distinguished Public Lecture on Thursday next week. So we hope many of you will come. There is on our website a place to sign up. There's no charge, of course, but we do need people to sign up and register because of limited seating. So having said that, I want to also mention after that we have a follow-up series of speakers that are equally spectacular. On May 18th, we have a gap in April, but May 18th, David Scorton, the secretary of the Smithsonian Institute, will be here to give the Distinguished Public Lecture. Following that, Warren Leonard will be here to speak about immunodeficiencies. And following that, in the first week of June, Josh Gordon, the newly appointed director of the National Institute of Mental Health, will be here to speak about innovations in psychiatric diagnosis and care. So it's a spectacular series. We hope to see many of you, if not all of you, at the follow-up lectures. And with that, I'll have the pleasure of introducing today's speaker. Today's speaker is Dr. Al Reece from the University of Maryland. Dr. Reece holds a variety of titles there. He's Dean of the Medical School. He's Vice President for Medical Affairs, and he's the John and Akiko Bowers Distinguished Professor as well. Dr. Reece is somebody I've had the pleasure of knowing for a number of years as a colleague, and I like to think as a friend. I think of him as a mentor in many ways, so it doesn't mean he's older than me. It just means that I look up to him and his career and have learned things from interacting with him. He received his medical degree from New York University, his degree in biochemistry, that's a PhD in biochemistry, from the University of the West Indies, and then went on and did an MBA from Temple University. He did his residency in obstetrics and gynecology at Columbia, New York, then did postdoctoral training in maternal and fetal medicine at Yale University School of Medicine. He was invited from there to join the faculty at Yale School of Medicine, which he did and served in that capacity for several years. And then he was chair of OBGYN at Temple. And then after that, went to Arkansas University for Medical Sciences, where he served as the vice chancellor and the dean of the School of Medicine, and then made his move to the University of Maryland several years ago. Dr. Reece is an elected member of the U.S. National Academy of Medicine, formerly called the Institute of Medicine of the National Academy of Sciences. He's a fellow of the National Academy of Inventors, and honestly, you don't see a whole lot of deans of medical schools or fellows of the National Academy of Inventors. He is a member of the National Medical Association, or having received their presidential award. He served in the past and currently serves as a PI on multiple NIH research grants. Again, you don't see a lot of deans of medical schools that serve as PIs on multiple NIH research grants. And these are in areas of maternal diabetes, induced neural tube deficits, induced heart defects from maternal diabetes, and autophagy regulation in diabetic embryopathies. He serves on the governing and scientific advisory boards of the National Academy of Medicine, the Massachusetts General Hospital, the VA's Advisory Committee, the March of Dimes Committee on Prematurity. He's actively involved in leadership of Research America, that some of you may know, one of the greatest advocacy groups for the importance of research in medicine and health, and also with the National Academy of Sciences Committees on Science, Engineering, and Public Affairs. And he serves on multiple national leadership positions relating to women's and children's health. In addition, he's a great supporter of research, from very basic science research to translational, clinical, and applied research as well. He's truly a champion of science and medicine on the national stage, as well as at the institutions where he has served in leadership positions, including his current position at the University of Maryland. He has absolutely developed, cultured, and nurtured there a culture of discovery, science, and medicine, integrated in a way that I think is an outstanding model for the nation. He is taking on scientifically, policy-wise, and in terms of healthcare, the challenge of the epidemic of obesity and diabetes in this country, and its profound, potentially damaging effects on the developing fetus in pregnant women. He is studying the scientific basis of how maternal hyperglycemia activates key enzymes that can lead to neural tube deficits through causing enhanced activation of cell death in the neural tube, congenital heart defects in diabetes through enhanced oxidative cellular stress and cell death. And beyond that, he moves his scientific discoveries to the public and policy. So he truly represents the entire continuum. There aren't a lot of people like that out there, I guarantee you. He publishes and speaks articulately on the importance of the role of the nation's biomedical research enterprise at academic medical centers. So it's a real honor to have Dr. Reece here. Please join me in welcoming him to the VTCRINCO.
Thank you, Michael. Dr. Fralin, thank you very much. Could you hear me in the back? Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me to this very distinguished lecture series. First, let me thank the Schulmans, Mrs. Schulman, for making it possible for you to be here and for your husband to name to be attached to this distinguished lecture series. So I always want to honor those who have made these fora possible for us to come together to share science or medicine. So thank you very much. Thank you, Michael, for inviting me here. I've been learning a lot about this institution as I have spoken with a number of persons throughout the day. I got to congratulate you on a number of things that are happening here. And I've said to Dr. Freelander earlier that there's something quite interesting happening here, being nurtured here. And this collaboration between various institutions is not very common to be as successful as this has been so far. And one should not take it for granted, because it is a unique model that I really am impressed by. So congratulations to you and to all of you who have made this possible. Well, today I have a difficult task to speak to a very mixed audience. And so I hope that what I will convey will be impactful for the public and for the scientific audience and for the clinical audience and for the educators in the group as well. I want to talk to you about a topic that is becoming quite rampant in the world, and that topic is diabetes, and sometimes by extension, obesity, and we'll talk more about it. But particularly, I want to focus on the uniqueness between the multi-generational effects of these diseases, and try to understand first the biology. It is very difficult to try to introduce treatment of anything unless one understands the biology of what's happening. If you do otherwise, you're basically doing by trial and error. Sometimes it works, and sometimes it doesn't. So we try to understand the biology. So let me start by indicating that I have no conflict of interest, financial or otherwise, with regard to what I have to say. I want to start with how health, good and bad, is indeed passed down. So let me start with Charles a conversion of Charles Dickens' novel, A Tale of Two Cities, and talk about A Tale of Two Sisters. And if you look at this, for example, it's not intended to be any specific pedigree. But the essence of it is as follows. Can you see this red dot? Can you see it? Yeah, what you'll see here is that they're two sisters. They start out healthy. They have offspring. Some are healthy. Some are overweight or obese. Some develop diabetes and then diabetic pregnancy and end up with a birth defect, a child with a birth defect. One may have normal weight. And just get a flavor for another sister, may have a different pattern, but some similarities. Offspring overweight, healthy here. But the general idea is that having a number of risk factors, thanks. Having a number of risk factors, may predispose someone to have a diabetic pregnancy and birth defects. So the question that one may ask is, can we change these stories? So that's what I want to discuss with you. Let's start with a brief history about diabetes. And hopefully I'll bring everyone together from a historical perspective. Diabetes was once thought to be incompatible, or rather pregnancy was once thought to be incompatible with diabetes. And for those in the audience who are advanced in age may remember, if someone had diabetes, it was unheard of to even be considering having a pregnancy. So before 1856, there are few reports in the literature about diabetes. In 1882, there are only 22 cases that were reported worldwide. And this is 1882. Now, at the turn of the century, the 20th century, only 66 cases were reported, diabetes and pregnancy. So again, you see the incompatibility of diabetes and pregnancy. But more importantly, you'll see, look at the outcome. 25% of the women died, and 30% of those pregnancies ended up in adverse outcomes, whether it be abortions or stillbirths. Now, this is an important year to remember. In 1920, the infant death rate was as high as 70%. Now, remember, that is the year before insulin was discovered, 1920. So it becomes important for you to know where we were prior to insulin discovery. In 1921, and do we have medical students in this audience? Wonderful, wonderful. And here's a plug for medical students' discovery in science. It turns out, as you know, that insulin was not around. People had diabetes. We didn't even know what happened. Well, it turns out that Professor Banting, pictured here, was at the University of Toronto in Canada. He listened to a lecture and got the idea that he could make a difference. He believed he understood, hypothesized. That was his hypothesis in his mind regarding how to make a difference. So he applied to the head of the laboratory, who was Dr. McLeod. And his grant application was, Dr. McLeod, I need 2 medical students, and I need 2 dogs, and I need a little lab space. And he got it. How about that? That's a very high pay line. He got it right away. The 2 medical students, one was Best and one was Nornin. And they basically flipped coins and said, who would work with Dr. Banting first? Well, certainly the student Best decided. And they were planning to have cycles, 1 week on, 1 week another student, and so on and so forth. But after the first week, they didn't really accomplish much. So they decided, the cycles are too short. Let's have them monthly cycles. And so Best worked with Professor Banting for a month. By the end of the month, they had extracted from the pancreas the distillate, the substance from the pancreas that they called at the time pancrein. And it was a crude product. And before you know it, they started to purify this pancrein. Well, my poor friend, the other medical student, was kind of out of luck, because the month had rolled on and Bess was well on its way. And so this crude product was purified. And here is Best, the medical student Best. And you see how medical students dress those days very nicely. And they had this was one of the two dogs. Well, they actually pancreatectomized the dog, removed the pancreas from the dog, so the dog became diabetic, and injected this crude product in the dog. And by the next day, the dog that almost was dead started walking around. And the rest is history. They obviously purified, Eli Lilly got involved and purified this pancreatin until it became insulin. And Leonard Taylor was the first person in the United States at the Joslin Clinic to have received insulin. And so that was 1921. What really is important to remember is this discovery, and I've always said, by a medical student, this discovery by a medical student has changed the world. This discovery led to a Nobel Prize, Banting and Best. Now, there's a little historical information here. The Nobel Prize was not given to Best, the student. It was given to Banting and MacLeod, the lab director. But Banting was such a nice man, he divided the Nobel Prize money with the student, 50-50. So nevertheless, we come to know that the discovery was by Banting and Best, but the Nobel Prize was not labeled. The medical student got dropped out of the labeling in the Nobel Prize, but we know he had the Nobel Prize. So from our perspective, this is a real giant. The perinatal mortality fell significantly. The maternal mortality was 45% before insulin. It fell to 2%. And that's the 1920s, 1930s. The mortality rate of infants fell from 70% down to maybe 15% at the time and continued to decline. And huge transformational change in the world of maternal and fetal medicine. Well, we're going to fast forward to the early 80s. But there is a professor at the time was Dr. Priscilla White. Dr. White was at the Joslin Clinic. Women at the time, very few women were in medicine, and very few women were in research medicine. Dr. White, who actually established the so-called White classification, class A, B, C, D, F, R, T, is Dr. White, and she was at Joslin Clinic. She reflected, it turns out that, let me just fast forward a little bit. In the early 80s, I was writing my first diabetes text, and I wanted to dedicate it to Dr. White because of what she did for diabetes and pregnancy. At the time, Dr. White was retired, late 80s, maybe 90, in that range. And she worked at the Joslin Clinic. So I called the Joslin Clinic and said, I'm Albert Reece. I'd like to talk to Dr. White. She's no longer here. She's retired. I mean, I knew she wasn't here, but I wanted to just get them to answer and give me where she was. I said, could I get her a forwarding address? It says, no, we're not allowed to give a forwarding address. So, well, I'd like to tour the story. Well, I'm sorry, we can't give it. So I was persistent. I called at different times and get somebody else and so on. And eventually, somebody gave me Dr. White's address and phone number. They thought I was a nice guy, and I basically called Dr. White and went to visit her. So here, by visiting Dr. White, a few things, Michael. This is my only picture with a tie like that that exists in the world. So I went to visit Dr. White. I took my nurses. I took different things, and I was in our living room. And Dr. White was not married, so she had her caretaker with her, a long-standing person. But the wonderful thing is I was able to talk. It's like talking to your grandmother. She was able to tell me things like, I said, how did you take care of diabetic patients before insulin and during pregnancy? So this is what she said. Diabetic women were discouraged from becoming pregnant. Termination of pregnancy was often recommended. Fetal death was a common occurrence. Premature delivery was required. Maternal and perinatal mortality were high before insulin, but declined subsequently. Longevity with diabetes resulted in medical complications. The incidence of birth defects, however, has been unchanged. So, and she went on to, there were some other things, and we can talk about it privately after this. It was just a wonderful, wonderful interview, and asking her, how do you treat a type 1 diabetic who doesn't make insulin before the insulin was available? How many calories did you give patients at the time? And she'd say the girls would hardly make it to childbearing, and the girls would actually die in childbirth, and so on and so forth. So it was a wonderful interview. But this caught my interest. This was a problem that existed then, before insulin, and has persisted unchanged. So my question, so I want to now tell you of a case. And for the students again, I think this is sort of important. And this is a case, a very pivotal case in my career. And this is a situation how sometimes things in life that are unpredictable can begin a course in your whole career that was totally one that you had not planned. Well, I was a fellow, a postdoctoral fellow at Yale in the early 80s. And my first, among the first patients I saw was Mrs. P. Mrs. P walks in, 24 years old, female patient with lifelong diabetes. Probably had, I think she had from age one. She had advanced renal insufficiency, proliferative retinopathy, she was legally blind, she had hypertension, she was taking antihypertensive medication, and she had experienced a prior fetal loss. And she presented the Yale High-Risk Clinic. She was 8 weeks pregnant and was discouraged from becoming pregnant. So she come to a different place now to see what they would think. And she met this young whippersnapper person, yours truly. And she presented herself to me. And she said something that just changed the course in my life and maybe hers. She said, Dr. Reece, I'm willing to give a little of my life for a child, quote, unquote. So this young whippersnapper was not convinced that any of these should preclude her from having a pregnancy, from continuing a pregnancy. So the story was kind of interesting, and I'll just start with the first part. So being a fresh junior fella, I went to the senior professors and presented this case. And one of the senior faculty said, Al, don't touch this lady. This is trouble. She's gonna decompensate, and she's gonna have all kinds of different problems. She's gonna get blind, she's gonna lose, you know, and so forth. And she's obviously very sick, very, very sick. So I still remain unconvinced, but I want to be polite. I didn't exactly say I don't agree. So I went to the library and I researched it, and I couldn't find any data to show that pregnancy would accelerate the rate of decline of these. They existed. These are progressive disease. Anyway, this could be a man. And the question is, does pregnancy accelerate, change the slope of any of those disorders? I want you to hold that thought now until the end of my talk. So what are the barriers to success? We talked about the preclinical era. We know what that is. We didn't have insulin, the pre-insulin era, and so there's a very high rate. The post-insulin era, what happened? Stringent glucose control, blood pressure control, plus fetal monitoring resulted in improvement in both maternal and fetal outcomes. Both mother, infants, and the fetuses improved. But what remained then and today is the challenge of high rates of birth defects and prematurity, but let's focus on the birth defects. Today, the modern era, we're having another factor, obesity, and sometimes referred to as diabesity, with adverse outcomes. Birth defects remain a major concern. If you look at the CDC puts out this heat map every so many years. But what it shows, if you look at this side, is the obesity and diabetes. But you'll see from 1994 through 2014, the darker the map, the worse the disease gets. And you can see how it's getting darker, very dark, You can see how they mirror each other, very dark. But what you can see is that, let's look at the future, between by 2040, 2030, you'll see that in the Americas, for just use the Americas where we are, the significant increase in diabetes from 2050 to 2030. But look at this. We're a small country, relatively speaking. We have 330 million people. Both China and India had 1.5 or 1.2 billion people. But even then, the number, we're number three in the world with regard to the incidence of diabetes, despite our relatively small size. So this is pretty serious. We'll look at what will happen. And then you'll see what happens. The world is going to go from 415 to 642 million by 2030. So that is not going to change. But important to think about, women will be in this group. Women will become pregnant and will have the tale of two sisters where they'll be presented to their obstetrician and they'll be at high risk for delivering infants with birth defects. So the points to remember, that women who have diabetes, are obese, and pregnant have multiple complications. They have longer hospital stays, require more medications, and they have more spend more time with the doctors. They have many more complications. They could be obstetrical, like cesarean section, preeclampsia, or hypertension, or they could be medical, like blood clots, thromboses, or various forms of diabetes. Again, there could be complications, again, like having birth defects on the short term or the long term sequelae, as shown in that slide. It turns out that several years ago, there was a professor from the United Kingdom by the name of David Barker, actually Sir David Barker. And Sir David, many years ago, in the early 80s, in fact, he came to Yale, and I was a fellow at the time, I was supposed to be his tour guide. In giving him tours, he had this idea that I thought was a crazy idea. You know, as a young guy, I was still in my late 20s or early 30s, I forgot now, and at the time he could have been like 60, so he that those days he was like really old man. And I said he just didn't really get it. And he said to me while we're walking around, you know, I think a lot of the diseases that we have these days, hypertension, coronary disease, actually began in utero. And I'm thinking, well, this guy really has lost it. How could this occur in utero? You know, these are adult people. So I was being polite. I just showed him, shook my head. And we walked from place to place and we talked around. Well, Sir David made a presentation and he pointed out that these coronary diseases actually, he believed, is hypothesis, just like Professor Banting. All of these start with someone having a hypothesis, or first sometimes a hunch that leads to a hypothesis that has to be tested. So and he proposed then that the roots of chronic diseases in adulthood really began in utero. And there was a relationship between birth weight and the lifetime risk of chronic disease. I'm going to fast forward. Sir David, after a while, has shown through a number of population studies that indeed, when there is lower birth weight, there's a higher risk of developing coronary heart disease. Indeed, when there's lower birth weight, particularly when there's a fast catch-up growth, there's a higher rate of hypertension, stroke, and type 2 diabetes. That has been proven. It's now sometimes called adult disease of fetal origin. So it's a whole new disease state. A few years ago, I wanted to make up with Professor Sir David, so I invited him to come to University of Maryland to give a lecture. I would apologize for even thinking that he was old and not didn't quite get it and realize that he really was way ahead of his time. He agreed to come to give this lecture and unfortunately passed away before. His appointed lecture. So, but nevertheless, he has made a huge contribution to science by having the hypothesis, first the hunch hypothesis, and then he used population science to prove his point. What he has shown is that the in utero environment has short-term impact, birth defects, but also long-term impact like heart disease, hypertension, stroke, and so on. That's been proven. So let's start into birth defects, the short-term impact. That's really what I want to focus on. Here we have women, birth defects in the general population, the non-diabetic population, is about 2 to 3% on average. So there are 4 million pregnancies in the United States at any one time. Right now, about 2% will be born with birth defects, background rate. Among the diabetic population, almost 10% will be born with birth defects. I don't mean little pimples. I mean serious birth defects from heart defects, spina bifida, defects that can cause death of the children. So this is not innocuous or something that is simple. I want to emphasize the order of magnitude I'm referring to. Well, the question is, what do we know? What do we know about the disease state? Well, what we know is the following. And this is using hemoglobin A1C, or glycosylated hemoglobin. And when we measure glycosylated hemoglobin, that assesses glucose concentration over a six-week period of time. And let's say this is a less than 6%, for example. The malformation rate, this is in humans now, was about 3%. But look at what happened here. As the glycemic control, as measured by hemoglobin A1C, or glycosylated hemoglobin, increased to about 15%, the malformation rate increased to about 40% in humans. This is humans. So we have seen here that there's a link between diabetes, or I should say hyperglycemia, and birth defects. We see that there is that kind of a relationship. Now, as everyone knows in the audience, those are associations. Those are not causality. We cannot invoke cause. We can invoke there's a relationship between X and Y. They may or may not be causal, but there's certainly an association. So that's the first thing we know. We know that as recently as 2010, 8,000 babies were born in the United States that had birth defects. Again, as a result of diabetes. Not in general, but as a result of diabetes. Diabetes-induced birth defects. So this becomes quite serious. We also know one other thing. These are probably 10 or 12 international randomized clinical trials where populations were randomized to one group of population of women having the usual care, and another group of women having stringent glycemic control and then looking at outcome. And what you can see here, for example, is you look at this is a malformation rate, this is a control group, and this is a study group. There's a difference between the malformation rate in the control, usual care, to the stringent control, almost a half. Now, in East Germany, when there was an East Germany, they had one hospital for diabetic patients nationwide. And they had a lot more, there's a communist country, so they could tell you when to get pregnant. So they had a very strict, they decided to do a study. And the study was Kurt Furman, who was the, see if I can find it. Let's show you a second, right here, this is the one. Kurt Furman is a friend of mine. He told me that in Germany, and he's the author, in East Germany at the time, they began the study where they would randomize women to usual care or to tight control. And they would, those in the tight control, they would regulate their glucose to achieve normality, normal level. And only then they would give them the green light to get pregnant. So they were able to manipulate the, and I'm using the word manipulate in a positive way, to regulate the, almost like an experimental study. But what they've shown is the following, something extraordinary, that the malformation rate was almost eliminated with tight control versus usual care. So no other study in the world was able to be as effective, because what happens is that, you know, people got pregnant along the way. So you had, even the United States, we had this Kitzmiller study, 15% versus 2.2%. Pedersen was the large US NIH study, 14% versus 7.4%. All it shows is the fact that when one has tight glycemic control, one seems to have fewer malformations. So the question is, so what's the problem? Why not just simply have everyone do tight control? It's easier said than done. One is that several reasons. Number one, most pregnancies in the United States in this audience is unplanned. So people don't always plan to get pregnant and thus tightly control their glucose level. Next, the diagnosis of pregnancy typically occurs after the critical period of organ formation occurs, between weeks 2 to weeks 6 to 8. And often people realize they're pregnant maybe week 6. Most of the organs are already formed, so that damage would have already occurred. Next is the achievement of euglycemia is easier said than done. It's difficult to achieve and difficult to maintain. So just saying, well, all you have to do is avoid hyperglycemia. Well, it's easier for the doctor to say that, but it's very difficult to the patient to achieve that level of stringency early in the pregnancy and maintain it throughout, at least throughout the first trimester. And there really is no specific therapeutic intervention to achieve that. But the question that haunts me as a scientist is why? That's probably the most potent question a scientist can ask. Dr. Freelander, the why and the how. That's what we live for. We live to ask the why, and we live to ask the how, and that is our life. So we ask, why do women with diabetes deliver more infants with malformations? Why aren't birth defects preventable? Why? And one way to find out is the how. So first of all, we're going to ask ourselves a question. We'll take this big question, why and how. And I'll show you that what we have done over the years, we have an experimental laboratory where we've studied this problem for years. And I'll share with you, it's going to get a little bit more scientific or a little more basic, so please stay with me. We're going to use an in vitro approach and an in vivo approach. And they start with the in vitro approach. We'll use rat or mouse embryo with and without hyperglycemia. We'll talk later on about in vivo approach, where we're going to use streptozotocin to ablate the pancreatic cells, and we'll focus on some specific outcomes. So this is an example of a spina bifida, a meningocele, of a fetus whose mother has diabetes. So this is the example. This is the model that we've used. We basically mate rats overnight, or mice for that matter, mate them overnight. The next day, we check the vaginal plug, see if they're pregnant, and if they are, we allow the pregnancy to continue until about day 8. We remove the embryos and place the embryos in a roller bottle. We rotate the bottle at 30 RPMs for 2 days. Because in the rat, organogenesis, organ formation, is between day 10 to day 12. In the human, it's weeks 2 to week 7, let's say. In the mice, it's between day 8 to day 10. So this is the critical period of organ formation. So that's when we actually will. So we rotate it for 2 days using an RPM, and we provide gas of O2, CO2, and nitrogen. And then at the end of it, we examine the embryos. So we examine in the normal condition, this is a control. And then we experimentally include D-glucose at different concentrations, from 350 milligrams up to 950 milligrams. Basically, the normal glucose level in a rat is about 125, 130. So we do 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 5 times, 6 times, to see what happens. So we ask the first question, is hyperglycemia a teratogen? Is the problem really hyperglycemia? Is hyperglycemia causing the injury? That's the first question. Can we say it is causal? And so we've used the experiment, I'm not going to repeat it all the time, but we use the same in vitro model, and we use a control, and we use a group 1, where we culture in D-glucose from 350 to 950, and we had a group 2, where we use L-glucose. L-glucose is not metabolized by humans, by animals for that matter, and use the same approach. Do a 48 hours, and actually what we find is the following, that that we were able to induce these same type of heart or neural tube defects by increasing concentration of D-glucose. So embryos exposed to D-glucose basically had defects. Embryos exposed to L-glucose had no defects, even at almost 1,000 milligrams of glucose. Demonstrated that hyperglycemia is a teratogen. We can induce the malformation at will, but at the same time, we could not induce it with L-glucose. That is not metabolizable. It's the osmolality increased, but that is not the cause of the defects. And we're showing that the defects occur at different tissue levels, the yolk sac, the neural tube, the heart. We then ask the question, what is the role of the dose and the age? And what we show here, use the same approach, is that we took a different dose. A dose of 150, and we found 3.5% malformed. A dose of 300, double it, 20% malformed. A dose of 600, 50% malformed. A dose of 950, we were seeing 100% malformed. So we show clearly that as we increase the intensity, the concentration of D-glucose, the malformation rate increased. We then expose the embryos early in that organogenesis period. Day 10, we're getting more neural tube defects. And towards day 11, more cardiac defects. And day 12, no defects. Demonstrating again that there's a role for dose and there's a role for age. So we can conclude that diabetic teratogenesis can be induced by hyperglycemia in a dose-dependent manner, and different malformations will occur at different ages within a vulnerable window. It shows how unique development is. It's highly tuned. And I didn't point one out, I think, also, that all of these need to be occurring simultaneously. So the defects occur at a threshold. So below 300, you're not getting defects. So there's a threshold. And below a certain age or beyond a certain age, there are no defects. At the same time, increasing amounts of D-glucose creates defects. So we are at least, and these are examples. Here's an example of the level of glucose. This is a background rate of malformation. We triple it, and we almost get a 30% increase in malformation. And these are the type of malformation you're getting. Some of them have little or no brain, anencephaly, or meningocele. But the point is that we are able to introduce the defects at will, and now we can study them. So let's switch to an in vivo model, where we're now taking a rat or a mouse, using streptozotocin, inject into the tail vein. It enters the bloodstream and will go to the pancreas and ablate the pancreatic islet cells. We do that, and we wait a couple days, and if the glucose goes up to 250 milligrams per deciliter, that's the diagnosis of diabetes in the rat. We then introduce an insulin pellet so we can normalize the glucose. And after a few days of a normal glucose, then we mate them. So for experimental purity, you want to do this so there's no evidence of any streptozotocin that's there that could be considered as causing the malformation. So you wait, use the insulin pellet, normalize the glucose, wait for several days, and then you mate them in a euglycemic state. They become pregnant, and on day 5, you remove the on day five, you remove the insulin, so the glucose is very high during the period of organ development. And then about day 10, you can remove the embryos for examination. So at least you're able to expose the embryos in utero to the highest level of glucose during the period of organ formation, in vivo. So we have done a number of studies to try to, what we're interested in again is now why. We think we understand why. Now we're asking how. How does it occur? How does hyperglycemia ends up causing this defect in the back? What is the map that we can create? Almost like a road map. We'd love to know a map, because if we knew the map, we could hope potentially intervene along the way. We could put some stoplights. We could put some policemen along the way so we can alter the outcome. So we got to know the map. So here we go. So this is a very busy looking slide, but stick with me. What we're proposing, this is a hypothesis, that hyperglycemia induces oxidative stress. By definition, is increase in free radicals and a decrease in the antioxidant capacity. So the free radicals are called ROS, that's reactive oxygen species. So that's our hypothesis, that hyperglycemia is increased and it causes increased oxidative stress, which is free radicals up, antioxidant down. And that leads to excess apoptosis or excess cell death. And excess cell death results in the birth defect itself. We propose that there are at least multiple pathways that are involved, but at least two are dominant. One is a pathway along the membrane called the membrane phospholipid signaling pathway. And the other is a series of antioxidant pathway or a stress activated pathway. Be that as it may, they come together to increase cell death and result in embryopathy. So that's our hypothesis. And we've been able to prove each of these steps. So to bring it together and just sort of a focus on, to make it in a simplified way, we have demonstrated that there are at least three major events that cause the problem. Event number one is at the membrane, that hyperglycemia, how am I doing with time? Okay, that hyperglycemia causes membrane injury. It injures the membrane, so glucose freely enters, just oozes into the cell. So that's one event. So, but hold that thought. It enters the cell and cell, it injures the cell membrane and cell organelle membrane. So it freely enters the cell and freely enters the mitochondria. So here you have a lot of glucose in the mitochondria, which means a lot of substrate. Glucose under normal conditions will be oxidized to CO2 and water and free radicals normally. But the free radicals are cleaved, are removed by scavengers. Under conditions of hyperglycemia, what we've shown is that one, the membrane gets injured, glucose comes in, just sort of slushes in, goes through and slushes into the mitochondria. So you have excess oxidative phosphorylation, excess CO2 and water, and excess free radicals. The scavenging enzyme, superoxide dismutase, catalase, and glutathione peroxidase, are there. So it is. We have not clarified this. Either they have been decreased or they have been overwhelmed, which means they are relatively decreased. But be that as it may, they are excess free radicals. So that's event number two. That now triggers event number three. It activates a protein kinase pathway. There are 12 isoforms in protein kinase, but only alpha, beta 2, and delta are activated in this particular pathway. Once that activated, it activates a series of pro-apoptotic. Apoptosis is the pathway to defect, but it activates a series of pro-apoptotic intermediates resulting in the birth defects. So those three, and I'm going to share with you, I'm going to prove those to you now. Take number one, event number one, membrane, and you'll see that both this is the yolk sac, and this is the embryo. And this is what normally looks like under euglycemia, what it looks like under hyperglycemia. Under light microscopy, you see a beautiful epithelium, you see a mesothelium, and you see the red cells already start forming. Under electron microscopy, you see beautiful brush border. You see all the organelles, see the mitochondria, you see the ER, very rich organelle. Look what's happened under hyperglycemia. The embryo is very small, very eccentric, malformed. You'll see on the LM light microscope, very different. Under electron microscopy, the brush border, the microvilli is abnormal, and the cell organelle is like washed out for those in a very lay audience. When we compare these two by actually counting the organelle, there's significant depletion in the protein making machinery. So we see a significant difference in the morphology and the morphologic structures. The same thing happens on the embryo tissue. Here is the light microscopy of the normal appearance. Look what happened under hyperglycemia. The neural tube stops. What happens normally is, remember from neuroscience, cells are the daughter cells go in the next layer. So you're going to have more daughter cells in the next layer than in the first layer. So the cell tends to move around. The tube comes around to create the neural tube for the spinal cord. But what happened? It stops halfway before coming together. Why? Look what happened. Under normal conditions, the cells look very immature, blast-like. Look what happened under hyperglycemia. It starts to specialize. It matures. There's premature aging. Premature aging before this neural tube has closed. So we see here that there's decrease in mitosis, there's decrease in proliferation, and there's acceleration of aging. Occurring at the level of, and also the ER morphology has changed. In the interest of time, I'm going to move along quickly. Biochemically, you'll see that the membrane, we've also demonstrated that the membrane lipids and phospholipids are also decreased. We've also shown in the ER stress that these are stress markers called BIP and PERC, CHOP. They're all increased. And this is a Western blood analysis. They're all increased. Demonstrated that these are stress biomarkers that are activated. So we see clearly that the event number one has been shown and proven. If we look at event number two, that's the level, that's event number two right down here, where the mitochondria is having excess free radicals. We can demonstrate it in the interest of time, if you look, for example, we use a dye, dihydroergotamine, which is red, and it detects free radicals. You'll see how bright this is over in the diabetic side. And so we're demonstrating also the presence of excess free radicals in this tissue. Let's go further. We then ask the question, well, if indeed this is true, that the scavenging enzymes are able to remove the free radicals, then if we gave extra scavenging enzyme, we should get lower birth defects. In theory, that should make sense. So we decided to do that. I set up a collaboration with the Weizmann Institute in Israel. And Professor Gruner at the Weizmann Institute had some transgenic mice that basically had the SOD, the superoxide dismutase, were SOD positive, and made them SOD positive. And so they expressed the superoxide dismutase in greater amounts than the normal. In the interest of time, the bottom line. When we had the diabetic mice, well, let's look at this. The non-diabetic, the malformation rate is 8.5 and 8.5, let's say. No difference, transgenic or control. Now, the diabetic had 16%. We just made them transgenic, did not change the diabetic state. Back to background, demonstrating clearly that by removing the free radicals, we've been able to reduce the malformation rate to background. So our conclusion was that despite significant hyperglycemia, increased SOD scavenger ameliorated the rate of neural tube defect. Now, we just recently had a paper published in Science Signaling, which I think really has put the capstone on, that indeed hyperglycemia activates ASK1, FOXO3, caspase 8, the whole pathway. So this whole pathway that I just shared with you, we demonstrated and proven. In the interest of time, I'll say to the audience briefly that these are protein analysis. These are Western blood analysis to decide if these pathways are indeed activated, as I said earlier, that the free radicals activate those pathways. Those are pro-apoptotic pathways that make apoptosis occur and the embryopathy. All I want to say is that this is an intermediate called JNK, it's a kinase. And using this protein analysis, these are diabetics but normal, diabetic but malformed, and see how upregulated, activated, how prominent these proteins are. Demonstrating here that under conditions of hyperglycemia, when there is malformation, this intermediate is very activated, both in the embryo and in the yolk sac. We then ask the question, what is regulating JNK? What is regulating it? The next slide will show that what we've shown here is that right above JNK is ASK, which is apoptosis signaling kinase by definition. And what we've shown here is that if you look at this, for example, this is J and K on the y-axis. On the normal conditions, the amount of J and K is at this level. With the diabetic, the J and K is activated, right here, it's activated. We then simply use a delete this gene, and here J and K has fallen, demonstrating that in fact, that the ASK controls the J and K. Likewise, let's look at number three. We then look at the apoptosis and see whether that was increased. Indeed, using this assay called tunnel assay, we can demonstrate that the number of apoptotic cells have been decreased simply by removing the gene up here. We asked the question, is this just in rats and mice? But could it really be happening in humans? Well, we have a brain bank that is supported by the NIH. So we went into the brain bank and asked to get some tissue that would have neural tube defect of infants. Kind of same example. So we had one, we had two, neural tube defect in one and two cases. They were age match controlled. Bottom line, in terms of time, we're able to show the same thing, that in a neural tube case, we had activation of caspase 8. Caspase 8 is going to be right here. And also, the FOXO was decreased. So we have clearly the ASK was increased. Very similar findings, almost identical findings in the human to show that is a pathway. So to bring it back together, these are the three events that we believe creates a map for what is happening. We then believe that with knowing that information, we can actually intervene therapeutically. So we have sought patents, we have patents on many of these intermediates because we believe and we've shown that by stabilizing the membrane with lipids, which it was depleted in, we should decrease the outcome, and we have done that. We've shown that if we add more scavengers to event number two, we should decrease the outcome, meaning the birth defect should be decreased, and we've shown that. We've shown that if we develop blockades of these pathways, inhibitors, we should be able to decrease the outcome, and you should decrease the birth defects, and we have shown that. So here's a quick run. We then develop a rat model where we have made the rats diabetic, and sent my scientists to a health food store. I wanted to make it real relevant to buy evening primrose oil and safflower oil because they are high in arachidonic acid, which I said earlier they were deficient in. And I then fed vitamin E to the rats in terms of time, and this is the dosage, and the malformation rate fell from 21% to 7%. Fed them safflower oil high in arachidonic acid. So we're working on event number one at the membrane. The rate fall from 20% to 7.5%. More membrane stabilizer fall. What we notice is that one, that dietary supplementation of the deficient substrates reduced the birth defect but did not bring it to background. And lastly, it hit me one day, but why should it? Almost anything in biology is multifaceted. The body is very complicated. It's not just as simple as like driving a plane. There are lots of backup buttons all the time. So we decided that maybe we should actually try to have two events, target two events. So we created a cocktail of safflower oil, myonostal, and vitamin E. So you're hitting event number one and event number two. Here are the controls. Here are the controls. And the control is non-diabetic. We use the double strength of the cocktail with the control, or we use insulin, around 4%. Just a diabetic without cocktail, almost 24% malformation rate. We added cocktail, quarter strength, reduces 20%. Added cocktail, half strength, reduces 6.5%. Added the cocktail, full strength, reduces 5.5%. Double strength, 4%. So we're able to eliminate excess malformation by targeting that which we understood, the map. And that's event number one, event number two. We then, a friend of mine from CDC decided to do a human study and use 6,000 patients in the Atlanta area and sent out a series of questionnaires and asked the question, there were several questions, but one was, were you taking multivitamins 3 months before pregnancy and during the first trimester of pregnancy? Because it's high in antioxidant. Here's the bottom line. Those who are diabetic not taking vitamins had a fourfold increase in birth defects, demonstrating that antioxidant, at least event number two, is very important in reproducing and preventing malformation. My last one is this one, and this is something that we're working on. We have a new patent on this, and we're actually trying to look at a potential commercialization. Thyridoxin is an inhibitor of ASK1. So you remember ASK1 is right here, an inhibitor of ASK1. Thyridoxin is very interesting. It's physiologic. It's basically ubiquitous. But when it associates with ASK1, it prevents it from becoming activated. It's in the reduced form. In the reduced form, it binds to ASK1. It keeps it quiet, non-activated. When it gets oxidized, it dissociates from ASK1 and becomes activated. So it's antioxidative, anti-apoptotic, and anti-inflammatory. So we did a study. And what we did here is event number three we're working on. And so you'll see that here's the diabetic group. Here's the non-diabetic group. The malformation rate is zero. The malformation rate is zero. The number of malformations is zero, obviously. The diabetic, 418 milligrams per deciliter of glucose. The malformation rate, 38% versus zero. We then just added thyridoxin, the physiologic inhibitor of ASK1 activation. The malformation rate fell to 4%. So thyridoxin treatment, the reason why, because that's an agent used in infants. So really, it's physiologic and it's used clinically. Reduces malformation rate in embryos. So we've shown you a number of things, which I'm gonna skip these slides and go right to the bottom line. Because this is, what this is really, so where we are now is that we have, I didn't show you these slides, we have some new data showing that in addition, it appears that diabetes can also create DNA hypermethylation, which results in neural tube defect, neurogenesis failure, by increasing the DNA methyltransferase enzyme by increasing the DNA methyltransferase 3B gene, and the microRNA 200B increase misfolded protein. But all of these new information, these are epigenetic information, are also pointing to the same factors. Simply saying that hyperglycemia may work also through epigenetic factors to create the same end result. So we have can show that we can block that, and we can change the outcome here and here in the same way. So, Mike, I'm going to end where I started. So we believe and we have shown that having understood this molecular map, this roadmap of the how, we believe we can indeed change the stories of the tale of two sisters. Let me end with my story on Mrs. P, who actually I have credited for my life, my career. Mrs. P, after I convinced my professor that there was no data to demonstrate that the pregnancy would accelerate the complications she already had, he conceded that we should be careful, we should proceed, make sure she signs a consent, and so on and so forth. I was happy to move along. And those days we had no cell phones, but I gave her my home phone and my beeper and all of that, and managed her tightly. Tight control, tight blood pressure control, high level of monitoring, weekly evaluation. She continued to get sick. She went into pre-renal failure. We put a shunt into her, prepare for it. During the course of pregnancy, she went into congestive heart failure. My colleagues said we should deliver her. I said, if this were a man, we wouldn't say that. We'd just diurese the man. So we diuresed her, and she went back, sent her back home, and took her to full term, delivered her, and so this is how, and this is Mrs. P. So she would send me a picture every year asking me, Dr. Reece, how are you doing? I thought it was extremely nice. So this is my little Kathy that really has been a real catalyst in a quest for answers on a topic that is so very important. So what will we explore next? We want to understand the mechanism underlying organelle stress. We want to explore the role of ER stress and unfolded protein response that I didn't have a chance to explain to you, and also investigate the effect of high glucose on neurogenesis and cardiogenesis. We want to identify biomarkers for early diagnosis. We want to develop dietary supplements and other substances for potential intervention and initiate a clinical trial in early pregnancy to prevent these birth defects. I want to end by acknowledging my research laboratory. These are the senior members in the laboratory. These are our postdocs and a couple technicians here. And these, I want to thank the NIH and the American Diabetes Association for supporting our work over the years and at present. These are the faces of people who did most of the work, and grateful for their work. So with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention. Thanks for inviting me.